Welcome to Reid's Reads, the reading show where Reid reads Reid's Reads for Reid's fellow readers. I'm your host, Jack Reid. Last episode, we finished chapter 3 of Terry Goodkind's Wizard's First Rule, book 1 in the Sword of Truth series. And it was a doozy. It was... Wow, there was a lot. I said that so much in the last video. I went back and looked at it and I said that a lot, but it's because it was. There was so much weird in that chapter. To recap, quickly, chapter 3, well, the second part of chapter 3, because we've already been over the first part of chapter 3, in which nothing happened. The second part of chapter 3 was we met Richard's brother Michael, who is a politician. He is the first counselor, I think was the title, of Westland, which is the place where Richard lives. And I had these suspicions through chapter 1 and a little bit of chapter 2 and the beginning of chapter 3, where I saw these little hints and clues of, maybe Michael but might be kind of a bad guy. And then the end of chapter 3 happened, and they stopped being subtle. Wow, did they stop being subtle. He, Terry, Mr. Goodkind, stopped being subtle at all about the kind of person Michael was. Michael is a showboating prick who is also extraordinarily gross, and has a weird obsession with fire that apparently the rest of Westland shares, because he's building his political platform on people suggesting ways to keep people from dying in fires. And there's so much wrong with that. There's so much weird about that. Why would you make that choice? There's been a lot of things in the first two chapters. There were times where I was like, okay, now this is a weird thing that you don't really do in writing. And it's strange that he did that, but it was a writing decision. And that's... But this? This is pure nonsense. I can't rant too much about this because we've got to get on to chapter 4, but... It was just utter insanity that Michael took the directions he took in his opening speech, and that the rest of the crowd was 100%, like, nobody in the crowd was like, what? Why are you talking about, what does that have to do with me and my crops? Or my sheep? Or my, like, it was so strange, and I don't understand the decision. And I really hope we come back to that. The chapter ended with Michael getting super handsy with Kahlan. And not like a little handsy, like grab her, yank her into his crotch, and be like, you're coming home with me. You're saying no? Too bad. You're coming home with me. And it was gross. It's like Tony the Tiger, you know? It's gross! That's how it was. And Kahlan responded by slicing open his chest with a fingernail, about which I also ranted, because that's not generally how fingernails or skin works. But... Anyway, and Michael left, and no, excuse me, Kahlan left, and Richard followed after her. Now, the other thing that I feel like is actually, like, all the other stuff I ranted about, I feel like is mostly, it was weird, it was whatever, but there was something else that happened that I actually feel like it's pertinent to the plot, and that is, near the beginning of this section, Kahlan noticed that there were men who were watching, not her, as we might have assumed, because she's the outsider and she's got this weird dress and she's clearly not from around here. And but no, they weren't watching her. They were They weren't watching her. They were watching Richard, which is very interesting. We also learned that Michael probably had something to do with his dad's death. Like I said, they really stopped being subtle about Michael. He's just plain a bad guy. That's all there. He's a villain. That's all there is to it. And so with that, We begin chapter 4. Richard ran down the walkway to catch up with her. Remember the thing I mentioned earlier about establishing the subject before using the pronoun? That. Kahlan's dress and long hair flowed behind as she marched along in the late afternoon sunlight. When she reached a tree, she stopped and waited. For the second time that day, she wiped blood off her hand. As he touched her shoulder, she turned, her calm face showing no emotion. "Kahlan, I'm sorry," she cut him off. "Do not apologize. What your brother did, he was not doing to me. He was doing to you." Oh, that's interesting. I probably should have thought about that in all my ranting. Oh, well. "To me? What do you mean?" "Your brother is jealous of you." Her face softened. "He's not stupid, Richard. He knew I was with you, and he was jealous." Richard took her arm and started walking down the road, away from Michael's house. He was furious with Michael, and at the same time he was ashamed of his anger. He felt as if he were letting his father down. "That's no excuse. He's first counselor."
"I got it right."
"Yeah." "Okay. He has all anyone could want. I'm sorry I didn't put a stop to it." "I didn't want you to. It was for me to do. What he wants is whatever you have. If you had stopped him, having me would be a contest he would have to win. This way, he has no more interest in me. Besides, what he did to you about your mother was worse. Would you have wanted me to have stepped in on your behalf?" Richard put his eyes back to the road. He choked off his anger. "That's really not healthy, just in general." "No, that was not for you to do." As they walked, the houses became smaller, closer together, but remained clean and well kept. Some of their owners were out taking advantage of the good weather to make repairs before winter. The air was clean and crisp, and Richard knew by the dryness of it that it would be a cold night, the right kind of night for a fire of birch logs, fragrant, but not too hot. The white-fenced yards gave way to larger garden plots in front of small cottages set farther back from the road. As he walked, Richard plucked an oak leaf from a branch hanging close to the road. "You seem to know a lot about people. You're very perceptive. I mean, about why they do what they do." I guess it's not obvious to him, but like he already guessed that she was somebody important in the last chapter, and it's kind of like, well, duh. Like, you don't get to be somebody important in society without learning how to read people. Well, I guess you can, but generally speaking, successfully, yeah, reading people is... Anyway, whatever, he's just making the comment. Let's move on. She shrugged. "I guess." He tore little pieces off the leaf. "Is that why they hunt you?" She looked over as they walked, and when his eyes came to her, she answered, "They hunt me because they fear truth. One reason I trust you is because you do not." He smiled at the compliment. He liked the answer, even though he wasn't sure what it meant. "You aren't about to kick me, are you?" A grin came to her face. "You're getting close." She thought a moment, the smile fading, and went on. "I am sorry, Richard, but for now you must trust me. The more I tell you, the greater the danger, to both of us. Still friends?" "Still friends." He threw the skeleton of the leaf away. "But someday you will tell me all of it?" She nodded. "If I can, I promise I will." "Good," he said cheerfully. "After all, I am a seeker of truth." Kahlan, that was in, like, little quotation marks, by the way. "I am a seeker of truth." Kahlan jerked to a halt, grabbed his shirt sleeve, and spun him to face her wide eyes. "Why did you say that?" she demanded. "What? You mean seeker of truth? That's what Zed calls me, ever since I was little. He says I always insist on knowing the truth of things, so he calls me seeker of truth." He was surprised by her agitation. His eyes narrowed. "Why?" She started walking again. "Never mind." Somehow he seemed to have broached a sensitive subject. Oh, you think? His need to know... Sorry. It's weird that the author feels the need to inform us of that. It's like we couldn't have figured that out on his own, that she was a little put off by what he just said. Oh well. His need to know the answers started to shoulder its way around in his mind. They hunted her because they feared truth, he thought, and she became upset when he said he was a seeker of truth. Maybe she had become upset, he decided, because it made her fear for him, too. Can you at least tell me who they are, those who hunt you? She continued to watch the road as she walked next to him. He didn't know if she was going to answer him, but at last she did. They are the followers of a very wicked man. His name is Darken Rawl. Please do not ask any more for now. I do not wish to think of him. Darken Rawl. So, now he knew the name. That's a natural stopping point in the chapter. Let me see how much more we have left. There's a couple pages before the end, not the end, before the next stopping point in the chapter. It's nice that they broke this one up for us, by the way. So I'll go to the next stopping point, and we'll stop there. I didn't mention this at the beginning of the video, but I found out that when I go longer than about 30 minutes, that it actually causes problems with the video storage on my camera, which is a phone, by the way. And because it caps out there, that about a half hour is about 4 gigs in storage space. And at that point, the camera says, okay, time to make a new video. And we get the like 2 second gap that there was in the last episode. I'd like to avoid that in the future. So from now on, I actually am going to stick as hard as I can to the 30 minute rule, which works out to 7 to 9 pages ish. Depending on how much ranting I'm doing, really. So yeah. Continuing on. The late afternoon sun was behind the hills of the Heartland Woods, allowing the air to cool as they passed through gently rolling hills of hardwood forest. They didn't talk. He didn't care to talk anyway, as his hand was hurting and he was feeling a little dizzy. A bath and a warm bed were what he wanted. Better to give her the bed, he thought. He would sleep in his favorite chair, the one with the squeak. That sounded good, too. It had been a long day, and he ached. That's a nice little touch, the one with the squeak. I think that automatically, that was a good choice by the author, because it automatically, for me anyway, it automatically made me think of my favorite chair that squeaks, which was a big blue armchair that my parents have, and other armchairs similar to it. And I think that was a calculated decision that he wanted to make everybody think of their favorite chair. Smart move. That's good writing. Continuing on. By a stand of birch, he turned her up the small trail that would lead past his house. He watched her walking in front of him on the narrow path, picking spiderwebs off her face and arms as she broke the strands strung across their way. Richard was eager to get home, along with his knife and the other things he had forgotten to take along. There was something else he had to have, a very important thing his father had given him. His father had made him... Oh, I think we're getting the secret thing that Richard, like, hinted at last chapter. Here we go. I'm ready. I'm excited. His father had made him the guardian of a secret. Made him the keeper of a secret book, and had given Richard something to keep always, as proof to the true owner of the book that it was not stolen but rescued for safe keeping. It was a triangular-shaped tooth, 3 fingers wide. Richard had strung a leather thong to it so he could wear it around his neck, but like his knife and backpack, he had stupidly left the house without it. Well, he said it was stupid. He was impatient to have it back around his neck. Without it, he couldn't prove his father wasn't a thief. Right, because the book belongs to somebody, right? That's a big tooth. That, I don't know if that was, my hand was outside the camera range there, but that's a really big tooth. That's like prehistoric shark tooth. That's big. Okay. Higher up, after an open area of bare rock, the maples, oaks, and birches began to give way to spruce. The forest floor lost its green for a quiet brown mat of needles. As they walked along, an uneasy feeling began to itch at him. He gently took Kahlan's sleeve between his thumb and forefinger, pulling her back. "Let me go first," he said quietly. She looked at him and obeyed without question. For the next half hour he slowed the pace, studying the ground and inspecting every branch close to the trail. Richard stopped at the base of the last ridge before his house and squatted them down beside a patch of ferns. "What's wrong?" she asked. He shook his head. "Maybe nothing," he whispered, "but someone has been up the trail this afternoon." He picked up a flattened pine cone, looking at it for a short time before tossing it away.
"How do you know?"
"Spiderwebs." He looked up the hill. "There aren't any spiderwebs across the trail. Someone has been up the trail and broken them. The spiders haven't had time to string more, so there aren't any." How narrow is this trail? Because that's a long way for spiders to spin a web. It seems to me. I don't know about that. I don't know if I buy that. I didn't really question it when Kahlan was brushing spiderwebs away, but I don't know that I've ever been on a forest trail that had spiderwebs strung across it. Like, I've gone walking off the trail, and trees were close enough together that there were spiderwebs between them. But trails tend to be, if you think about a decent forest trail is probably minimum 2 feet wide, probably more like 3 feet wide. And then add to that, really, that space is probably the distance, like that 3 feet is just a clear space, and that's like where the branches end from the trees on either side. That's a long way for a spider to spin a web. I don't think I buy that. I think that was a bad move on his part. Like, he was trying to be clever and be like, ooh, he knew someone had been here because there were no spider webs, but I'm calling bullcrap on that one. Okay. So, the spiders haven't had time to string more, so there aren't any. Does anyone else live up this trail? No, it could be just a traveler passing through, but this trail isn't used much. Kahlan frowned, perplexed. When I was walking in front, there were spiderwebs all over. I was picking them off my face every 10 steps. That's what I'm talking about, he whispered. No one had been up that part of the trail all day, but since the open place we came through, there haven't been any more. How could that be? Well, probably because somebody walked through it. He shook his head. I don't know. Either someone came out of the woods back by the clearing and then went up by the trail, a very hard way to travel, he looked her in the eyes, or they dropped in out of the sky. My house is over this hill. Let's keep our eyes sharp. So that's interesting that he made that point, because there were no tracks at his father's murder. So I think, I don't know, I feel like right now Terry is wanting me to believe that whoever or whatever killed his dad is now here. I don't know that I necessarily believe that, though, because that's how far we are into the book, and I have a hard time believing that we're going to introduce the actual father's killer this early. So I think it's probably more likely to me, to my assumption. Plus, so the question of how they would have gotten there occurs to me. And I feel like it's a pretty safe assumption that if teleportation was a thing that the bad guys could manage, or whoever is here, I don't, maybe it's, could be a red herring, maybe it's not the bad guys at all, but if teleportation was a thing they could pull off, then the quad wouldn't have had a problem getting to Kahlan, I feel like. Because I feel like Richard is a much smaller fish in the story thus far compared to Kahlan. For the magic people, anyway. I could be wrong about that. There's plenty about Richard I don't know. But it makes me think that the only way to have, like, gotten somebody there is literally, like Richard said, dropped out of the sky, which would imply some sort of flying mode of transportation. And I feel like we would have noticed that. Somebody would have noticed that if there was an airplane or something that dropped a parachuter into that clearing. So I guess what I'm saying is I have no idea. And that was silly conjecture. It wasn't a conjecture. That's the wrong word. Oh, well. It was a silly tangent is what it was. I shouldn't have bothered because I don't have any good suggestions. So, my house is over the hill. Let's keep our eyes sharp. Richard carefully led the two of them up the rise, both scanning the woods as they went. He wanted to run in the other direction, take them away from here, but he couldn't. He wasn't running away without the tooth his father had given him for safekeeping. Okay, I'm stopping a lot. But why didn't he mention the tooth earlier? It feels weirdly episodic. Like, he's only mentioning this important thing right before we're going to encounter it. And that feels like a weird move to me as a reader, because I don't know. I feel like if there had been an opportunity earlier, like even in the first chapter, for him to be, I mean, he was concerned about the knife because he couldn't dig the thorn out of his skin. But if in that moment, or a similar moment, if he had gone, "Oh no, I don't have the thing." And then we could have been wondering what the thing was for two chapters and been like, what was that? Why did he care about the tooth? And then now, as he's getting closer and being agitated about, did somebody, like, I can't leave without that. Now we've had two chapters worth of buildup to get there, but instead, I have, like, two pages of buildup of going, okay, so I guess this is important because he's telling me it's important now. It feels like a flaw to me. Right. He wasn't running away without the tooth his father had given him for safekeeping. At the top of the rise, they crouched behind a big pine and looked down on his house. Windows were broken, and the door, which he always locked, stood open. Dun, dun, dun! His possessions were scattered about on the ground. Richard stood. It's been ransacked, just like my father's house! Right. She grabbed a fistful of his shirt and hauled him back down. Richard! She whispered angrily. Your father may have come home just like this. Maybe he just went in just like you are about to do, and they were waiting for him. She was right, of course. Duh. He ran his fingers through his hair, thinking. He looked back toward the house. Its back sat hard up against the woods, with its door facing the clearing. Since it was the only door, anyone inside would expect him to come running in that way. That's where they would wait, if they were inside. All right, he whispered back, but there's something inside I have to get. I'm not leaving without it. We can sneak around back. I'll get it, and then we will be away from here. Richard would have preferred not to take her, but he didn't want to leave her waiting on the trail alone. They made their way through the woods, through the tangle of brush skirting the house, giving it a wide berth. She's in a terrible outfit for sneaking, by the way. Like, the dress was already bad for wandering through the woods, but now you're trying to be stealthy? I say things like this a lot, but have you ever tried to be stealthy in a dress? Not easy. Never mind in the woods. Okay. They made their way through the house, through the tangle of brush, skirting the house, giving it a wide berth. When he reached the place where he would have to approach the back of the house, he motioned her to wait. She didn't like the idea, but he would take no argument. If there was anyone in there, he didn't want them getting her as well. It's funny, because I just had this momentary exchange in my head that he just sort of glossed over of Richard going, can you wait here? And her going, no, I'm not waiting here. I'm going, no, you stay. You you stay here. And like, that would have been funny. Would have been funny to have that moment. And he missed it. Okay. Which is funny because he spends so much time on other stuff. And then he missed a cool little character interaction that could have happened just there. Ugh. Leaving Kahlan under a spruce tree, that's exactly what I'm talking about. He added in the fact that she's waiting under a tree. And not just any tree, but he put in the specific kind of tree. And he's done things like that for the last 3.3 chapters now. And it's wasting space. It's not helping the story any to know that she was under a... well, I'm making assumptions, but I feel safe in making the assumption that it's not important to the story that he left her under a spruce tree. I feel like that's a pretty safe assumption. Okay. Leaving Kahlan under a spruce tree, Richard started cautiously toward the house, following a serpentine route to stay on the area of soft needles instead of treading on dry leaves. When he finally saw the back bedroom window, he stood frozen, listening. He heard no sound. Carefully, his heart pounding, he took slow, crouched steps. There was movement at his feet. A snake wriggled past his foot. He waited for it to pass. At the weathered back of the house, he gently put his hand on the bare wooden frame of the window and raised his head high enough to look inside. Most of the glass was broken out, and he could see that his bedroom was a mess. The bedding was slashed open, prized books were torn apart, and their pages strewn about the room. This only just occurred to me. I guess because it's the first time he's mentioned books in the plural. But nothing about this world has given me the feeling that there is a printing press. Do you know where we were at before we established a printing press so that we could mass produce books? We were... we had gunpowder before we had printing presses. I think. I should double check that. That might be wrong. But I feel pretty confident about that. But these people are swords and bows and tunics still at this point. And log cabins. And like... They're in the... Like, I guess... Well, you get the idea. It seems weird to me that there's books in this technological era. And I realize that's kind of a weird thing to nitpick because it's fantasy. Who knows what they came up with? But one of the things about fantasy, I'm running the risk of running over in this chapter, but I have to talk about this. One of the things about fantasy is that it primarily... fundamentally follows the rules of our own history. Things move at an appropriate scale. So it just seems odd that we had... I mean, you look at anywhere else, and... I guess I can't say that, can I? Because if we look at something like Wheel of Time... the discovery of, or at least the weaponization of gunpowder, is a massive plot point of the story. Spoiler if you haven't read it yet. But they have books everywhere. They're all over the place. Which now strikes me as weird that I hadn't thought about that before, but why are there books in Wheel of Time either? Because they're clearly pre that point in their... era of technology. In any case, the point I was going to make real quick, it's one of the primary differences between science fiction and fantasy, is that fantasy tends to follow a generally Earth-like structure of history and the world. You know, I'm sorry, I have hiccups and it's ridiculous. In fantasy, you don't expect that certain inventions jumped ahead of other certain inventions. And in... Did I say science fiction? I don't know. In fantasy, you don't expect that. In fantasy, you don't expect that gravity is different than Earth. you don't expect that that the medieval era happened at any other point in the progression of humanity than it did in the real world. You know, it took about, and here I'm going to show my lack of knowledge, but somewhere in the vicinity of, what, 8,000 years in the history of humanity? As like, cultured civilizations? That's wrong. That's so wrong, and I know it already. Anybody with any amount of history knowledge is going to laugh me out of the house for that statement. But you get it. I mean, it was 1,000... I'm going to stop saying things like this because I don't know when the printing press was invented, but I am fairly certain it was after 1000 AD, which puts it a long time. I'm going to stop because I'm ranting and I'm no longer certain if I'm correct, and there's no use in ranting about something that I don't actually know about. We're going to move on from the books, because that was... It feels weird, okay? That's all. Most of the glass was broken out, and he could see that his bedroom was a mess. The bedding was slashed open, prized books were torn apart, and their pages strewn about the floor. To the far side of the room, the door to the front room was opened part way, but not enough to see beyond. Without a wedge under it, there was the spot the door always swung to... Excuse me. Without a wedge under it, that was the spot the door always swung to on its own. Weird sentence structure. Slowly, he put his head in the window and looked down at his bed. Below the window was the bottom bedpost, and hanging from it were his pack and the leather thong with his tooth, right where he had left them. He brought his arm up and started to reach through the window. There was a squeak from the front room, a squeak he knew well. He went cold with fright. It was the squeak his chair made. Ooh, way to bring it back. Point it out in the beginning to give us a sense of home, and then bring it again here. Somebody is violating his space. They're in his chair. That's good. That was a good move. He had never fixed the squeak because it seemed a part of the chair's personality, and he couldn't bring himself to alter it. Soundlessly, he dropped back down. There could be no doubt. Someone was in the front room, sitting in his chair, waiting for him. You know, there's an actual stopping point later in the chapter, but I'm going to stop there. Okay. Let's talk about that real quick. That was the first half of chapter 4. And some nifty things happening. Mostly we had a little bit of character interaction between Richard and Kahlan. We established that she is a strong, independent woman who don't need no man. And had to point that out to Richard, you know, because he's kind of a clueless guy. Anyway. And they went walking along the trail, and they were cued to a possible intruder in the house by the lack of spiderwebs across the trail, to which I call bullshit. But for the purposes of the story, sure, why not? And they got to the house, and clearly someone had been there. The house was destroyed, and and Richard wound up going to the back window, and he's looked in the back of the house, and there is someone in the house, someone sitting in his chair, and it's Goldilocks! Or something. That's where we're at. This has been Terry Goodkind's Wizard's First Rule, Book 1 in the Sword of Truth series. If you haven't already, I highly recommend going and picking it up and reading along with me. Because again, all the things that I'm ranting about, I have to assume that they will be explained eventually, and that the people who know what's coming will be enjoying this very much. I don't have anything else to say about this chapter, I think. So, this has been Reid's Reads, and have a nice day.